We're here to promote cultural relations between the United Kingdom and Italy with regard to the arts, English and education. We have a very large teaching centre and we also have a very large examination service. We run exams for over 30,000 candidates a year. Some of you may have already done an exam with us. Most of our exams we run on behalf of the University of Cambridge. Cambridge ESOL is an examination board which specialises in English language exams. On your seat you should have a few leaflets. You should have an IELTS leaflet. Have you all got one of these? You can collect one from outside. IELTS is the UK University Admission English Language Exam. You also have CAE, you also have the Advanced leaflet, Cambridge Advanced, which is another Cambridge exam which is used for university admission to prove your language level. We're experts on exams, we're not experts on university admission. So we decided to invite an expert to come and talk to you to explain exactly how to go about applying for a British university. James Barton Steele is Assistant Director of MPW, which is a sixth form college in London, which specialises in preparation for UK university admission. And he's going to tell you all about how you can apply. You've also been given a leaflet, a form, to fill in. This is because James is also a consultant to Higher Education, which is an organisation here in Milan, which specialises in giving support to students who want to study in Britain. So if you want to fill in this form and hand it in at the end, Higher Education will contact you. Okay? I think I've spoken enough. So I'm going to hand you over to James, who I hope will tell you something that you want to hear, that will be useful and practical. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, my name is indeed James and I am the Assistant International Director of the MPW Group in London. Now I've given this presentation all over the world, literally all over the world, and I don't think I've ever seen so many people in one room at one time. So the best answer that I can probably give you this afternoon, don't panic. There's going to be a lot of information coming your way this afternoon. If you don't understand anything, stop me at any point, put up your hand, let me answer the question as we go, rather than save it for the end. This should be as interactive as it possibly can be, because I'm here with information, you're here with questions, and together we'll come up with an answer by the end of today's seminar. But the best place to start is to actually tell you how education in England works. And that's to tell you everything from school all the way through to master's programmes at university. At the age of 14 to 16 in England, your first assessed examination externally is the GCSE examinations. Once you've passed your GCSEs at the age of 16, you go on and you take the first of your A-level years, you take the AS level. In England, you have to pass every stage in order to get to the next one. So you pass your AS level, you go on to your A2 level. These two combined make up your A-levels. In England, A-levels are the best way of getting to a university in England. We do run the IB program in England, but A-levels still exist as the most old-fashioned and the best way of getting into a UK university. Once you've got your A-levels, you'll then go to university and you'll study a bachelor's degree, either a Bachelor of Arts or a Bachelor of Science degree. At the end of 3 years, you then have an optional choice. The optional choice is whether you would like to take a master's program in there. And some of you today might be here to ask questions about master's programs. Master's is entirely optional, and it needs to be based upon a good academic reason for you wanting to study that. So this is education in England. For you, as European students, you actually have three routes. The first route, which, as I'm saying here, is possibly the most achievable of them, is to come to England and do the A-levels. If you're 16 and you've got the opportunity, then you might want to consider doing 2 years of A-levels because it opens up all the universities in England to you. And that's anything from Oxford and Cambridge all the way down to somewhere like University of East Anglia or Southampton or something like that. The second option for you, if you're 18 at the moment, you might consider going to England and taking a foundation program. A foundation program is for students who don't currently have the necessary skills to start a bachelor's program at university. So if you wanted to come to England and study engineering, for example, but you're not very good or you haven't studied maths or physics, you might come to England, study a foundation program, and then you can apply to university after the one-year foundation route. The foundation route is also for students who do not belong to the UK, whose English needs to improve before you start a university course. In order to study in England on a bachelor's degree, your English has to be very good. The better your English, the more you will understand at university. It's no good just having an understanding of English. You need to take it further than that, otherwise you will not last the course. But the problem with a foundation course, if you do take the foundation route in England, is you cannot apply to all of the top universities in England if you take foundation. So if you wanted to go to Oxford, Cambridge, maybe the LSE, possibly UCL, the foundation route is not for you. You should be thinking at the age of 16 that you might want to take 2 year A-levels. Now the last route, the third route, is actually the one we're talking about today. For Italian students at the age of 18 who might want to apply for university right now. You can apply for university right now. It all depends on your academic grade at school and the level of English that you currently have. If those are good, then we fill in something called the UCAS application. Now, it would be criminal if I came to Italy and I didn't at least have a football analogy in here somewhere. So, who's this? Yeah, it's the Brazilian football team. This one?
Yeah.
Argentina, thank you. This one?
England.
There is a point to this, don't worry. England. And this one?
Spain.
Spain, absolutely. The World Cup last year. Spain won the World Cup. When they started, at the start of the tournament, they had a 16-1 chance of winning the World Cup. Now they won the World Cup, not because they had the best players, but because they had the best team. They had lots of very good players, and together, they made up the best team. The analogy here is when you are putting together your UCAS application, you need to combine all the very good parts about you in order to make up one big strong application. You have to think of all the component parts of a UCAS application, put them together, and then apply when it's as strong as it possibly can be. Your ratio is roughly 15-1 if you're applying to any of the following. Last year, the London School of Economics, the LSE, the one that everybody knows, 3,500 applicants for 210 places. That's a lot of people and not a lot of places. So you see why your application has to be very, very strong. Oxford. Economics and Management at Oxford last year, 1,000 applicants, 87 places. Don't panic. Okay. I'm instilling a sense of confidence in you, but very slowly. If you want to study medicine, Imperial College last year to all international and European students, it only had 21 places available. And Cambridge, I promise I'll stop after this one, but Cambridge Engineering, 1,500 applicants, 300 places. Okay. Now, if you are going to be applying for Oxford and Cambridge, which we'll come on to in a minute, at Oxford and Cambridge, it's all collegiate, which means there's lots of different colleges at the one university. At Jesus College, you had 872 applicants, 136 places, but the clever ones in this room will look at which colleges exist at Oxford and Cambridge and choose a college that has less applicants and more places available. So in the same year, I mean, Jesus College is one of the most famous colleges that there is. Girton College, not many people know, but by statistical analysis, 545 applications, 153 places. The ratio is much better for you. If you're clever about applying to an English university, you stand a very good chance. That's the point behind all of this today. The basics. If you want to take a note of any of this, please do as we go. UCAS is the University College Admission System in England. It's the application that any English student, European student, international student, you all do the same application in England. These are the deadlines that you need to be aware of. If you're going for medicine, veterinary science, dentistry, or an Oxford and Cambridge application, your deadline is the 15th of October. If you're here today thinking of applying for next year and you want to apply for Oxford or Cambridge, you have 1 week. Next Saturday, the application closes, and I can assure you there's been people planning an Oxbridge application for over a year. So if you are thinking of it, be very sure that you want to do it because you've got a very busy week ahead of you. If you don't want to apply to any of those, then you have till the 15th of January in order to put together all other applications. If you're here today because you want to study art, design, fashion, photography, any of that in England, you have until the 24th of March, so your application is much longer. These deadlines are not targets, they're deadlines. So therefore, you should always be applying as early as you possibly can. If I can tell you anything about English students, it's that we do like to leave things rather late. Therefore, a lot of English students will apply on the 14th of January. You don't want to make sure you're at the same time as them, because if you do, a lot of applications are being received at the same time, and you might find that a university admissions tutor does not look as favourably on your application as if you applied in 3 weeks' time from now, for example. Don't leave it to the last minute, because there's going to be a lot of students in the world that will leave it to the last minute. Yes, please. Well, the earliest date was actually the 1st of September. So the applications have been open since the 1st of September and they'll go through to the 15th of January. Some universities will not look at any application until the 15th of January. They've got all the applications in and then they'll start making decisions. That should be the most ethical way of doing it. It doesn't happen in practice from all the universities at all. Therefore, there will be some people out there who have already got a decision from a university that they've applied to. Therefore, being that we are now here in the start of October, the earlier we apply now, the better. You can apply for up to 5 choices on one application in England, unless you're going for medicine, veterinary science, or dentistry, where you can only apply for 4. All the applications are now done online. Okay, so I'm going to show you how you actually log on, how you can apply online later on. But there used to be a paper application. I remember when I did mine, I had to redo it about 12 times because you do make mistakes. Nowadays, you're in a luxurious position whereby it's all online. You can just fill it in as many times as you like and then finally click pay and send when you actually are convinced you might have got it right. Carrying on with the basics, at the end of March, you will definitely have received all your replies from the universities. That's the cut-off deadline for a university to have replied to you.
Thank you.
By the end of April, you have to have made your choice. So let's say you're in a very good position, you've received 5 offers from an English university, you now have to choose between your first and second choice. So you pick the one that you're definitely going to want to go to, and then you pick an insurance choice. The insurance choice should always be one that offers lower grades than any of the other universities. because if you do not get your first choice because your grade was not good enough, if you choose the same grade offer for the second one, you're not going there either. So the first choice should be your favourite, the best one you want to go to, and your second choice should be one that you're quite happy to go to, but the grades are that little bit lower. So by August the 16th, you will know if you're going to that university. What do you want to study? I mean, that's going to be one of the biggest questions of you coming here today, one of the biggest questions of you at your schools at this moment in time. What do you want to study when you leave school? If you have no idea, then I can recommend this as the best place to possibly start. www.ucas.com. You go to their website, you look at the course search on there. You can search through every single university in England, every single course that's available. You'll be told every single university that offers that course, what grades they might require of you. All right? And there's also another mechanism on that website, and it's called the Stanford test. On that website, if you have no idea what you want to do, and some of you might have taken the Moresby test in here already, the Stanford test is very similar. It just tries to work out something about you, try and match up a course to you based upon your interests, based upon your studies at school, find the right course for you. This bottom link here, this one's theguardian.co.uk, this is a league table. It's the league table of all the best universities in England, and, well, I say England, I should say Scotland, Wales and Ireland in there as well, but it's a link to the league table of all the best universities. It's the best universities and also a league table for the university that is best for your course. Sometimes these are different. Oxford and Cambridge are two of the most famous and best universities in the world. They are not always the best university for the department that you might be interested in. For example, if you wanted to go and study English literature at Oxford, it's very good. But the best place to study English literature in England, according to this year's league table, is actually the University of East Anglia, which not many of you might expect. Some departments at different universities are stronger than others, and this is why the league tables often help with your decision making. Right, I'm going to do a quick section on Oxbridge, because there might be some Oxbridge candidates here today, but you need to understand exactly what is going to happen if you are to do an Oxbridge application. The basic Oxbridge is Oxford and Cambridge just pushed together. What are they looking for? They want to know, are you academically able? Are you clever? Are you intelligent? Are you able to think? That's really what they want to know. Will you enjoy a challenging education? A term at Oxford or Cambridge is 8 weeks long, only 8 weeks. You have a lot of learning to do in 8 weeks, so you have to cram it all in. Are you going to be flexible enough? Is your brain athletic enough to get through a course in 8 weeks? But most importantly, do you have a passion for what you want to study? You should always have a passion for what you want to do in life. I'm passionate about what I do. Are you passionate about studying philosophy at university? And if you're not, then don't apply for it, because it will be picked up by them. But they're looking for the brightest and the best students, irrespective of where you come from. And this is why it doesn't matter what country you come from. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. It doesn't matter if your religious background. Anyone can apply for this university because they want to take the best students in the world. They will look at all of this criteria here. So the predicted grades, what are you predicted to get from the end of your high school qualification in Italy? They will look at all your academic results to date. They want to see how far back they can take it with you. They will look at the UCAS personal statement that we're going to come onto. And they will look at the UCAS reference as well. And this will be written by your school. If you pass all of that, then you might be asked to submit a written test or some written work. There'll be an admissions test that you have to do, which equally we will come onto. And there'll be some more written work required, which will be the job of the school to send over a transcript of your best academic piece of work. If you get through all of that, then you go to interview. Okay? An interview is a whole different ballgame. But every applicant, and this should reassure you, every applicant in this room will be treated as an individual candidate. You will have everything considered about your application. and you will go to interview as an individual. You will be interviewed by roughly three different people and possibly two or three different colleges when you're there. Standard conditional offers, if you're doing the IB at the moment, you need to be looking at roughly 40 to 42 as your final score. If you're taking your diploma at the moment, you need to be looking around 95%. They are completely inflexible when it comes to your final grade. So if you get 39 in the IB and they offered you 40, you're not going. If you don't get what they ask you for, they do not make exceptions, or at least it's very, very rare for them to make an exception. If you're going to sit an admissions test, if you're doing medicine, veterinary science, dentistry, you'll either take the BMAT examination or you will take the UKCAT examination. For most other subjects, you take the TSA, so the thinking skills assessment in there. And then you have college tests and step papers for mathematics. Depending on the subject you want to take, depends on the admissions test that you might be asked to do. I thought this might be at least interesting for you. In England, if you want to apply for Oxford or Cambridge, you have to get straight A's, or this new ridiculous A-star system in England. You have to get straight A's. The equivalent for you of three A's is 95%. So have a look at that chart and see where you think you are on that list at this moment in time, and it might give you an idea of how competitive this can actually be.
Sorry.
Yes.
This is valid just for Cambridge and Oxford, or for
No, this is valid for any university. At the moment, all I'm doing is talking about Oxford and Cambridge. Oxford and Cambridge are up here. The reassuring thing is that most UK universities will actually be around this bracket here. So anything from your 70 to your 80 is probably where you should be. For example, King's College London, which is one of our best universities, they will offer anything from 70 to 85, depending on the subject that you want to study. Okay, so there are completely different universities that apply for different grades. Choose a course. Choose a college. Like we said before, do your research. Look on the Oxbridge website. Ask people. Make sure everything you've researched as much as you possibly can. Find the one that will actually offer you the better chance of applying there. You do the electronic application online, you get it done by the 15th of October, and then they will send you an SAQ, a supplementary questionnaire. And now this is a pointless questionnaire really, it just asks you for extra information about you. Okay, just little bits and pieces that if you go to interview, they will actually be able to ask you there and then. Okay, so from your point of view, do not panic about it. It is just a formality. The written work, the test, the interviews will be mid-December. Okay, so anything from the 1st of December through to the 14th of December, and you might find out the next day if you've got an offer, or the very latest will be early January. This will be one of the earlier universities that replies to you. Decision in early January, if you've got an offer, they'll give you a yes. If they don't, you get a no and you'll get a nice sorry letter. Or the alternative is that you might be put in a pool. A pool means that your college thought you were good, but they don't have a place for you because they only have eight places for applicants this year. But they might think another college would like your application. So they will forward your application to a different college. If they like your application, then you might find that then you get the yes, or then you get the no or sorry. So there's three different options that you might get back from Oxford or Cambridge. Okay, winning your place. How do you do this? That's the trick. You've completed your online application. You have one form for your five choices. Therefore, what do I mean by that? Five choices, the five choices have to be the same course. You cannot apply for economics and contemporary modern dance on the same UCAS application form, because the personal statement that you're going to write will be talking entirely about economics. If that lands on the desk of the contemporary modern dance tutor And he looks at that and he's going to think, well, why are you applying to my course because you've written entirely about economics? You can be clever about this because you have such things as dual honours courses. So economics and something else. So you can have economics and business, or economics and geography, or economics and sociology. You can be clever provided that you have one overarching course that you are applying to. For most of you, this is going to be your only opportunity to sell yourself to a university. Okay. You have one form. Most universities do not interview you. Most universities will read this piece of paper and they'll say yes or no. It's a cruel world. Okay? If you have not sold yourself on this piece of paper, what chance do you have? So on this one personal statement you're going to do, and on the UCAS application, you're going to fill in your personal details and your application choices. What are your five choices? You're going to put down all the qualifications that you've gained so far, and that's anything. And that includes IELTS, it includes TEFL, it includes SATs if you've done those. You put down everything on there, but you're also going to have to put down what the best guess is for what you're going to get at the end of your high school. It's no point over-predicting for yourself, because if you don't get it, you're not going to the university. You have to be as honest as you possibly can and be as realistic about your own expectations as you can possibly be. So if you're only going to get 75, don't put down 85, because they'll make you an offer based upon 85. And if you don't get it... And then your school, your college, someone academic will write a reference for you. Parents, you cannot write the reference for your child, you cannot write the reference for a friend. You can only ask someone who is a certified academic to write this reference for you. Alright? How important is this personal statement? Well, it's extremely important. It's important for selective, competitive programs. All humanities programs, it's essential, because humanities implies a level of written English. This needs to be a very well-worded piece of writing, but most importantly, it needs to be your very well-worded piece of writing. And it's especially important as well for any course, any vocational course, that asks for work experience. So anything like medicine, for example. It's especially important to tell the university, what have you done? What have you learned? On the basis of the interview. The admissions tutor will read this personal statement and then ask you questions based upon it. So if you're very clever as well, you will also be writing this personal statement, giving food for thought for the admissions tutor to ask you about. They're not looking for a reason to not accept you into the university. Okay? They're looking for a reason to reject you. And if you give them a piece of paper with all of these wonderful different things about you that has so much creativity and so much scope for conversation, then you're going to have a much better interview than if you just write down bog standard basic information on there. Right. Why you? Okay. Because we have so many people in this room today. Why you? Why not the person sitting next to you? That's the question you should all be looking around and asking yourselves right now. Why you and why not the person next to you? And be thinking, who makes this decision? It's an admissions tutor who makes this decision. It is an academic who is a professional and an expert in their field. Therefore, if you're going to go for economics at university, know something about economics. All right, but don't take it so far that you actually try and teach them about economics in your personal statement, because that won't work for you. And what are they looking for? All they're looking for, okay, ask yourselves this question, what are they going to be looking for from me? They want to know about you. That is all that they are looking for. They are looking for commitment. They are looking for evidence of research. They're looking for your future plans. If you're going to go to university, you must, in the back of your head somewhere, know what you might want to do with your future. Do you want to be a lawyer? Do you want to be a banker? Do you want to be a milkman? What do you want to be? You will have this idea in your head. So what are your future plans? And do you have the suitable skills, the suitable qualities necessary in order to apply for this course? Now, can I just ask for your opinion here? Which of these words on the board right now is the most important one? Anyone? Not skills and qualities. Not commitment, actually. No. Evidence. Evidence. You can say anything you like on a piece of paper and they might never meet you. But you have to always be able to back up anything you say with evidence. So if you're going to have work experience, make sure you've actually done that work experience. Because if they ever get round to checking up on it, they need to make sure that it is there. And you need to make sure that it is there as well. Evidence. Everything you say, make sure you can justify. Make sure there is an argument for it. Make sure there is a piece of paper that says you have done this. That's what certificates are for. Preparation. Read. Research. Read the paper. Watch the news. Look on the internet. Know what is happening. Okay? If you're going, I've been through this many times in the past 48 hours, if you're going for economics or politics, you are all Italian students in this room, I'm presuming, but you are, most of you are Italian students in this room. There's quite a lot going on in terms of economics and politics in your country at this moment. Rather than open this up to a political debate, what I'm trying to say is know what is going on, because when you apply to a university in England, what makes you interesting, what makes you unique, is the fact you come from a different country, the fact that your system over here is different from our system in England. And if you have an appreciation of what is happening, it will actually be a very good indicator to a university admissions tutor that you're going to want to learn more about the course in England when you actually come over. You're going to want to learn about our economic system, you're going to want to learn about our system of government, etc., etc. So use what is all around you. Talk to people. Talk to me. Talk to your teachers at school. Talk to the British Council. Talk to anybody. But get as many opinions on this as you possibly can. And there is one set of people that you should definitely talk to. The admissions tutors at the university. Okay? If you'd like to know something about your course, email them. If you go on the website, they make their email addresses readily available for you on the web page. Email them. Any question, no matter how small, is right there. Make sure that if you are going to ask them a question, it's a sensible question. If you ask them for what grades you're going to need, all you're going to do is get a reply that says, well, please look on the grade page. But if you want to know a little bit about the course, and you want to be clever about this, email them and say, how many modules are available to me in the first year of study? How diverse a program can I put in place? Can I take a module from a different department? But all you're doing is opening up a dialogue with an admissions tutor who will ultimately look at your application. If you've spoken to them, by the time your form gets to them, they might recognise it. They might start thinking more favourably because you've been seen to be proactive. You are doing the research necessary. And then the last one, this is critical. This is the big one. This is work experience. Ask yourselves the question, do you have work experience? And I'm sure the answer to this might be no. Think of what you want to do at university and try and get some necessary, relevant experience that you will then be able to tell to the university that you have done. What work experience does is it confirms to you exactly, is this the right course for you? That's the point of work experience. Even if you're not applying for university and you're going straight to a job, you should always take experience first. You should always go and work for a week to find out if this is the right career path for you. Experience tells you a lot of things before you even get to the stage of application. Just recapping here for you. Okay, so the one personal statement for five applications. Joint honours courses in England are, in the UK, are easier to get into. For example, don't apply for economics if you could apply for mathematics in economics. If your mathematics is good enough to apply to a mathematics-based course. You have fewer applicants that apply for dual honours courses. When I showed you earlier that the LSE has 3,500 applicants for an economics course, for a mathematics and economics course, that number is in the hundreds, not in the thousands. So you're probably looking at more like 400 or 500 for every place for the applicants rather than 3,500. So be creative. Going over all ground here. English is capital letters important. Okay? Get your IELTS. IELTS scores, you need to typically be looking around a 7.0 if you're going to take IELTS. The London School of Economics will ask you for 7.0 in each one of the sections that you take. So in each of the four, you have to have got 7.0. If you get an overall 8.5 but a 6.5 in writing, you're not going. Okay? 7.0. But more than that, this is not just an entrance criteria. The better it is, the more likely you are to understand at university. Right, the personal statement. One page of A4, so one piece of paper. 650 words. That's all you have, roughly, to sell yourself. That's 4,000 characters with spaces, okay? So you only literally have one piece of paper that you can fill in for this application. It needs to say your reasons for choosing this subject. What are your reasons? Did you choose it? Did your parents choose it? Did your teacher choose it? Why do you want to study it? If your parents or your teacher chose it, don't write that, but come up with a reason as to why you are actually choosing this subject at university itself. So what is the reason? If you are going to study politics, what is the reason that you first thought about politics? Let's take a different subject. History. You want to study history at university. Which periods of history are you fascinated in, and how much reading and research have you done into those particular periods of history? How your studies at school have been relevant to the subject you want to study at university. So think about the subjects that you're studying at school at this moment in time, and think about how they will help you to study that course at university. This should not trip you up. It doesn't matter what you've studied at school necessarily. It matters what skills and what you've learned from those courses. You will have learned information about the subject, of course. But I like to think in England that A-levels, all they're doing is they're teaching you a set of skills, a set of qualities that are going to be necessary for you to study independently at university. So if you study maths at the moment, you're going to have problem-based skills. If you've studied a humanities subject, you're going to have analytical skills in there. Think of the skills and the qualities that you've actually learnt on these courses. Tell them about your future plans, we've just been through that. And all of this will come up with 75% of that piece of paper. So that's the majority on there. The final bit, you. What makes you unique? What makes you an individual? What do you like doing? Do you like playing sport? Are you sporty? Okay. Do you have any academic prizes that you've won at school? Do you hold a position of authority? Are you the head boy or the head girl or a prefect at school? What else makes up you? You should be looking at five paragraphs on this piece of paper. First paragraph, as we said, your reasons for choosing this subject. Why that subject? Paragraph two should be how your studies have been relevant to your studies at to your course at university. Paragraph three should be the work experience. We're going back to that paragraph here. Get that in there. Work experience. What have you done? Don't just say what you've done, but say what you learnt on that particular experience. Was it a useful experience, or was it not a useful experience? Paragraph four should be this idea of you, the extra, and that should be tiny. I mean really, really small, because you're cramming it in at the end of the piece of paper. And then paragraph five should be one sentence, maybe two sentences, and it should be a short, punchy statement of intent for the university. Why should they take you? Close this argument down. Imagine you're a lawyer. You're coming up with your closing statement here. What could you bring to the university? They want academics, of course they do. But they want great sports teams. They want to beat the other universities. They want people who are able to debate. They want people who are proactive with charity work and things like that. Find a nice, punchy last statement to use. An average personal statement, so an ordinary personal statement, will say, I want to do this course at university because I like it at school. It goes into more detail about you, and it starts listing 20 sports that you play and 15 awards and responsibilities that you've had. If your personal statement becomes more about you than your reason for studying the course, then you're going off the track. You need to pull it back in. I've seen personal statements where people close by saying, I like socialising, I like going out with friends. I even had a personal statement that I read that said, I'm really looking forward to going to university because I'm really looking forward to meeting lots of girls, which may arguably be true, but don't point it out to them. They're not naive, they understand, they're human, but you don't need to point it out to them, okay? Saying you like socialising, saying you like having friends, reading films, etc., not necessary information. That will make an ordinary personal statement. So the question is, how do you turn your ordinary, your average personal statement, into an excellent one? This is the game you have to play. Right, the first thing, clever, high-impact opening sentence. Something to grab them and pull them in straight away. Something that will talk about your course, something that will make a statement that you'll then be able to go on and talk about. Which is why I'm saying use what you have in this country anyway, what you know about, in order to pull in the audience straight away. You might want to leave the opening sentence or two to last, because this is the thing that everybody gets stuck about. How do I start this? Well, in fact, leave it to last, because it doesn't matter. You're writing five separate paragraphs here. They don't have to flow. This isn't an essay. So write five paragraphs independently, and maybe write this one last when you really know what you want to say. Over half this personal statement, the 75%, this is going to be about the subject area. It's going to show real passion for the subject. Academics at university love their subjects. That's why they do it. Okay. They're not people. They're not going to be particularly friendly, necessarily, because they spend their entire time in academics, or lecturing, or reading, or coming up with new areas of research. But the thing they love their subject, and they love to be able to talk to you about their subject. If you're clever enough, you'll look on the website, you'll look at the lecturers, and you'll look at the sort of work that they do. And it lists their research, because they're all quite vain. It'll list their research on there, it'll list all the books that they have written, and you might pick one up, you might look at the research they've done, you might try and tie that into your personal statement. If you're going for physics, you might find that a university lecturer particularly likes astrophysics, and you're taking astronomy in school at the moment, and you're able to tie that in somehow. Well, it's playing to their strengths there. It will have your work experience, your career aspirations in there. And it will explain, when we talk about social life and achievement, it will explain the context of that social life and that achievement. So you're saying why and not what. When you're saying why and not what, you're not just saying it, you're saying what you do and what you enjoy about that. If you've got a position of responsibility, you're saying why you were given it in the first place and what you have to do with that responsibility. You're looking at skills learnt and have you overcome any challenges, any setbacks in your life? One of the biggest challenges for you is going to be coming to England and studying at an English university in English. That is going to be a huge challenge. Don't shy away from pointing that out in the personal statement. It's honest. Saying one of the biggest challenges for me is going to be coming and taking on a new education in a new education system. But it's a challenge I think that I am ready for. Point it out, it's honest, back it up, justify it. This, show real personality. Don't get anyone else to write this for you. And maybe my best advice today is write it in Italian first. Know what you want to say in your own language and then get it into English. Don't go for English first, because you might not necessarily convey all that you might want to convey about yourself. You might not get your character, your charisma. Charisma is hugely important. It's the thing that draws people in towards you. Show your personality in there. Write in Italian first, then go on from there. One chance to get noticed. I'm just going to recap because we're at the end. One chance to get noticed. Deadlines are not targets. Earlier the better. Check carefully to avoid silly mistakes. Parents, if you're able to, please check over their applications. Check that they're not making mistakes. Get your tutors at school to check your grammatical errors as well, to get them to correct these. Show your personality, show your passion. Be reflective, don't just be descriptive. Get help, but make sure it is all you. Now this is where I just want to contradict myself. If you have a grammatical error in your personal statement, it doesn't matter, because that's you. You're Italian, you're not English. We're not expecting you to write in fluent English throughout your entire piece of writing. We don't mind the odd little mistake in there, because it shows something about you and where you're coming from. But it has to make sense. So, contradicting myself, what I'm trying to say is it has to make sense. And show you've done your research. Right. Interviews. If you go to interview, English interviews are known to be a little bit strange. Most universities won't interview you in England. Some do, and some will just ask you basic questions about yourself. So, hello, who are you? What's your name? Where do you come from? Tell me a little bit about why you want to study this course. Just really basic. If you get invited for an interview at the majority of universities in England, it's often a very good indicator that you're going to be offered a place at that university. It becomes a formality. They want you to see the place and check that they do like you and that they've understood you from that piece of paper. If you go for Oxford and Cambridge, or for medical school or anything like that, you're going to get some very strange questions. So, I don't know if anyone feels brave enough to answer these as we go, but I picked these three from three questions that my students were asked last year at an Oxford interview and a Cambridge interview for medicine. Tell me about this colour. That's it. That's the question. The colour is blue. The question is, tell me about this colour. Does anyone feel brave enough to try that one on?
I'm sure.
Sorry? It's not blue. It should be blue, but I think the lights and all of that, unless I've got horribly wrong. I am fractionally colourblind, so maybe not, but let's go with the idea that it is blue. You need to be thinking about what that colour means to you and what that colour means to the course that you're looking to study. So maybe if you study physics at school, or you want to study physics at university, you can talk about the spectrum of colours in there. If you're going for art and design courses, you can be talking about a palette of colours. If you're going for philosophy, you can be really contentious and say, well, is it blue? How do we know it's blue? I mean, these are the questions. These are the questions they're asking you. You just need to show that you can think outside the box. That's what they're looking for. Do you all understand what a brick is? A brick, something that makes a building. Yeah? I do actually want to ask you this question. Tell me 10 things you can do with a brick. Apart from building a building, that's one. Anything else you can do with a brick? Gosh, the silence is golden. You're going to fly through this interview. Okay. What can you do with a brick? A brick is a physical object. Okay? A brick doesn't have to stay in that object, it can be broken down and made up into other objects. What else can you be doing with that brick? These are just problem-based questions. And you might find that they pick up an object in the office at that moment in time. They might say, ask me 20 questions about this bottle of water. 20 questions about a bottle of water. You can come up with 20 questions, surely.
Is it sparkling water?
Is it sparkling water? Yes, absolutely.
Where does it come from?
Where does it come from?
Yeah,
20
is hot, actually.
20 is hot.
How much water is in it?
How much, yeah. What's in it? How much does it cost? I mean, you come up with about 8 of the basic questions. And then what you're going to find is your brain starts going blank. Because 20 questions isn't hard. But you're being put on the spot. And you're being asked to think about 20 questions at that moment in time. And you might want to look at the packaging of the bottle, or you might want to look at the You might want to ask a direct personal question, like, do you like water? Do you prefer tea? You can go well off topic, and it doesn't matter. You're only looking to ask 20 questions, but you're being put on the spot. That's the point of an interview in England, is you're being put on the spot, you're being asked to think, and you're being asked to be creative. So come up with the answers to the questions. I mentioned earlier that you might have to do the TSA as well, the Thinking Skills Assessment. These are often multiple choice and often comprehension based. But you're going to find that you have many different options that all sound relatively similar. So with the person next to you, I just want you to take 2 minutes, just read that. Can you all see it at the back? You might not be able to, so this exercise might not work for you. Okay. With the people nearer to the front then, take 2 minutes, just look at the question and see what you think the answer to this question is. Just talk it through with each other. What do you think the answer might be to this? This is the thinking skills assessment. This is what differentiates whether you're going to interview or not. And you have a lot of questions very similar to this. Okay? The occurrence of car fires is related to a lack of a fire extinguisher. Well, a fire is not caused just because you don't have a fire extinguisher in the car. So they all sound similar, but one of them will always be more obvious to you than others. Something will always jump out at you off that. You've got plenty of time, you just need to take your time, think about things. It's like the application. Take your time, do it properly, and you'll get to the final result. If you don't take your time, you do it too quickly, you're going to get the wrong answer and you're not going to get to where you need to be. Right. What can you do between now and January or October or March or whenever you're wanting to apply? You need to get started. You need to get thinking. If you want to come to England, you need to get onto the UCAS website, you need to talk to somebody about how this process works, and you need to start filling in that application form. There are many, many people that will help with this. You can come here to the British Council. If you need help with IELTS, sorry, yes, please. Okay, thank you. If you need help with your English or the UCAS, you can always come to the British Council. You can come to MPW and talk to us there. You can come to the Higher Education here in Milan, where I am based, and I'll be able to help you along with Mary and Annette over here. And we can help you fill in this application form and get you to the English universities. But you've got to get cracking on it. This is not a game for a last chance saloon. Don't leave this to the last minute. I sound like a broken record. I'm bored of the sound of my own voice, but don't. I feel like I'm lecturing you right now, but I'm really not. Just don't leave it to the last minute, okay? But here are three useful links. Any questions? Yes.
How do you try and
find you're an exchange student?
Yeah, like, should you try that?
Okay.
Did you say that?
Absolutely. Because it makes you different, it makes you unique. Which where are you on an exchange from? Okay. Right, definitely pull it in, because you've got two completely different education systems there. But do bring that in, it's interesting, it's relevant. Okay? You must have had experiences here in Milan that you wouldn't have got back home in Right, fine. In which case, you'll have had experiences over in America that you wouldn't necessarily have had over here. But it's interesting, so definitely bring that in. If you don't bring that in, it's naive, okay? You have to, because it's so interesting. Okay? And I'd probably do that in the first paragraph as well. Nice and early on. Really early on in the statement, just say exactly where you come from and why. Okay? Do we have any questions in this room? Because we've been through quite a lot of information here, some of which you might not have all got through. Yes, please.
I have a question about grades.
Grades, yes.
Use this application.
Yes.
I'm applying to England and also to Oxford.
Yeah.
And
I'm listening.
There's a problem with the grades, because when I try to insert the grades, they come up with lots of letters and numbers and different types of grades, and
yeah.
I don't know right.
Okay. On your UCAS application.
Levels, IBs.
Yeah. Well, on your UCAS application, the first thing you have to do under the education section is you need to fill in which system you're using. So if you're using the IB or what have you, you fill that part in first. Then you'll have the drop-down menus that will be there for you to be able to select the right qualification that you have. When it says about what the grades are at university, you'll often find it's all done in letter form, which is the purpose of this table here. Because it's an English university, first and foremost, it goes with the English letters. You need to translate it over. So if you're going for Oxford, did you say?
Yes.
Yes. So you are looking at about 95% is what you're going to be looking for Oxford there. Okay? You should be able to translate it over a little bit, but always just put in, is it the IB you do, or are you doing the diploma?
I'm on my last year.
Okay. Then just enter in the percentage that you think you're going to be able to get. I know getting a predicted grade from a school might be difficult, but I just need you to try and add in your best guess into that column. Okay. Yes, please, ma'am.
Yes. What's happening if the applicant at the
Durham
school?
Sorry, I beg your pardon. Which school? Right. Okay, sorry, that indeed was for the Italian system. For a German system, the qualification is still on the UCAS application. You just select the one that is relevant to the student. So if they're doing the European Baccalaureate or what have you in the German school, you'd select that one. And the form is clever enough to translate it over to any grade that you add in there. So you just have to select the qualification first, but make sure it's the right qualification for the right school. Yeah.
Where can I take and
prepare for the exam in Italy? In fact, can I refer them?
I would have a British council here. This is the only place where they would organise for you to do it. So you would need to ask a member of staff at the British Council.
Yes, please. Yes. Sorry, I'm going to come a little closer because I can't hear.
Just to know more about A levels.
How do you know more about A levels? Okay. Most English schools, if not all English schools, will do A level qualifications. An A level is done over 2 years, or there are some places in London, some colleges that will do 1 year A levels, which is the alternative to doing a foundation course. If you're thinking about foundation, you're probably actually better thinking about 1 year A-levels because then you open up all the universities to you at that stage. A-levels are done over 2 years because there's lots of information to get in there, but they are streamlined in 1 year if that's what you'd like to do.
And you have to be 16?
You have to be roughly 16, sort of 15, 16, depending on when your birthday is, in order to start the A-levels, and you'll finish at the age of roughly 17, 18, and that's when you start university. So it's for students at that stage of their life. Yeah. Part of the A-level system as well, no matter which school you go to, will be about educating you towards the universities in England, telling you about the different universities, directing you towards different universities. It's built into a school curriculum in England that you should be always educating about the wider society, but also about universities. So there's a lot built into A-levels as well.
Is it not possible to
study in
Italy?
Sorry,
Victor. If I started studying at school, obviously you can't go to England at the same time. So is it not possible through either internet open or
well, you can't really do an internet open course for an A-level. There might be schools in Italy where you can do A-levels, so that's where I'd refer.
No, not in Milan. No, apparently, no longer.
Apparently not in Milan, no longer. You can't do an A-level really online. It's not the same as a university degree, which you can do online. It would always be in a school that offers it. And if there are any in Italy, then definitely go for it. But if there are not, then it might be the IB is just as good as doing A-levels.
James, may I suggest that she comes to the seminar next week when we'll be talking about A-levels and the IB?
Sure. Sorry, madam. Apparently there is the seminar next week on UK schools and boarding schools and the IB and A-levels. There is a seminar next week that might answer your question a little bit better. Okay.
I'll ask her. Does she work here?
Sorry?
Am I this lady?
Yes.
I'll speak to you afterwards.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, please, at the back. You can't change. Right. Once you've applied, you can't change the personal statement that you've applied with. You can only go with that one personal statement. The only way you can change a personal statement is if you directly get into touch with a university and say that you've changed your mind on the course that you want to study, and therefore, can you apply for a different course, and you will write a new personal statement in order to show your intention. It's a system called UCAS Extra, but I haven't told you about it because it's not something you're going to really need. But in your situation, if that's what you want to do, and you change your mind, then you can apply directly to a university and give them a personal statement draft yourself. But you cannot do two applications through UCAS, you can only do one. And once you've done it, it's one application for five universities, you can't change it. Okay? Anyone else? Yes? Sorry, can you stand up for me? I can't see you. Sorry, I can't quite catch you. You've heard that a few universities offer
in January and February.
And late applications after the 15th of January, I think it is.
The deadline is the 15th of January. It's only a deadline. You can still apply afterwards, and some universities do expect European students to have applied after the 15th of January deadline, but they are not obliged to look at it. So it means you can apply, but they don't necessarily have to consider your application because they're trying to get you to work within their parameters and not your own. So if they're saying 15th of January, they really want you to try and stick within that deadline itself, okay? But you can apply afterwards, but it's less of a hard and fast rule as to whether you'll actually get in, because they might not consider your application after that time. Anyone else? Yes?
When you apply for scholarship, do you need to indicate the college already in your class?
Yes, absolutely. Oxford and Cambridge are collegiate, so there's lots of colleges there. And it's the same for Durham University in England as well. That's collegiate, so you've got different colleges you can apply to. You should apply to the specific college because it shows intent. It shows you've done your research. It shows that you know why you want to go to that particular university and that particular college. You can only choose one college. If you don't know the college you want to go to, you can do something called an open application. Now, an open application just means that you're not choosing a college and they will choose one for you to interview you. On their websites, what they say is that they consider both students, those who know which college they want to go to and those who are doing an open application. So it does not disadvantage you to go for an open application. The reality of it is, it does. So you should choose the college that you want to go to. That's just an equal opportunities policy. You should know the college you want to go to and why you want to go to that college.
Okay, so and then when you on the Guardian website,
yes,
you know which college is best for the subject?
Well, no, if on the Guardian website, you can do that for the subject. Mm-hmm. For the specific college at Cambridge or Oxford, you go to the Cambridge or Oxford website and you target on their colleges page which college you think you might want to go to. And there's lots of them, and so there'll be a lot of reading as to which one you might think. And some of them are the beautiful Harry Potter-esque colleges that you get there. And some of them are much newer, and they look like new build buildings there. So you might want to go to a specific college because of the architecture, you might want to go because of the old-fashioned reputation, you might just want to go to any college. And the newer-looking colleges at Oxford and Cambridge and Durham are the ones that get less applicants, because they're the ones that people don't know quite as well. So do look through them all and consider everything when you're going for the application. Yes, please.
Could you tell me something more about the painting skills assessment and interviews? And could you rewind the PowerPoint to the examples?
You want to go back to the example?
Yes.
Okay. The thinking skills assessment is what you will do on, more often than not, on the day of interview at Oxford or Cambridge. Okay. So what you're doing is you're doing the TSA. And the TSA is testing your flexibility. Okay. It's testing your brain. It's asking you lots and lots of different questions. Some of them are comprehension-based questions. You might find that there's some mathematical questions that appear in there as well. It's asking you for verbal and non-verbal reasoning. It's asking you for many different things, but it's also a test that you cannot revise for. You can't really revise for a TSA or an aptitude test. What you can do is you can practice for an aptitude test by doing as many different examples of questions from previous years. But aptitude tests are completely new every year. So for this year, it will not have been sat before, therefore no one knows, so you can't revise for it. You can do practice.
Are they basically for Oxford and Cambridge
colleges? Sorry, beg
pardon? Are they basically only for Cambridge and Oxford University, or...?
By and large, yes. For BMAT, UK CAS examinations, they're for medical schools. There's 40 different medical schools in England, so those will go around the place as well. If you're taking law, some universities outside of the Oxford and Cambridge realm will want the LMAT, which is the legal aptitude test. So you'll find that some universities specifically ask you for the LMAT testing in there. But you should always have in your head that most universities won't ask you for an aptitude test, but Oxford and Cambridge 100% will.
What about arts, the universities, for example?
Well, if you want to go and study art at university, I mean, that's not a UCAS application, so we haven't done it. That would be through a completely different application. It would be through the University of the Arts in London, which is a different application form that you literally just print off the website. And that's a very basic, why are you interested in art? What is your particular area of specialism? But you apply with a portfolio of work. So you have 20 pieces of work based around a theme. Let's say you choose your theme as blood. You come up with 20 pieces based around that particular theme of blood, okay? And then you apply that. There's no assessment aside from that for an arts college. In fact, to go to art school in London, you don't need particularly good academic grades. You need to have a lot of artistic potential and a portfolio that is better than anyone else's, but academic grades, not so much. Yes, please. No, it is not necessary to have IELTS before you do the application. It is necessary to do IELTS as early as you possibly can, because this qualification lasts for 2 years. It will run out, okay? So if you're young, take the IELTS when you're a little bit older. But with the IELTS, if you don't get the grade first time, you can take IELTS again as many times as you like until you get the grade that you need to go to university. If you don't do IELTS until August, and you only get 6 when you do the IELTS, you've missed a trick, okay? So I do IELTS as early as you possibly can, to be perfectly honest with you, but you don't have to have done it at the time of application, you have to have it by the time of going to university. Okay? You need to have got your IELTS by the time you go to university. If it's expired, you have to do it again before you can apply to university.
But after you have applied to a university, you have to do it again. After you enter to a university.
No. Okay, because your English should then be at such a level that it's just going to keep developing while you're at university itself. Okay. I will be around at the end. There will be other people around at the front at the end. If you have any questions that you haven't answered or didn't want to shout from the back, please come and ask them. Otherwise, very best of luck. Get started, get going on it. It's not complicated, it just needs to be done. Thank you.